So today,
is the video working?
I think it is recording, yes.
Yes.
So today we will be doing a sutta from Majjhima Nikaya, which is a sutta which is kind of a little controversial in certain aspects, because the meditation, as I had told on the first day, that there are many different point of view of meditation. So this sutta, Majjhima Nikaya 111, has certain aspects in its explanation of how you progress, which kind of comes in conflict with some other perspectives. So, my teacher Bhante Vimalaramsi gives a lot of importance to this sutta, because as per our experience and from our students' experience, this kind of matches the experience which we have found with the students. So that is the reason we give this sutta in every retreat. So this is one of the, some of the suttas we kind of change, but this is one of the standard suttas which we have in all the retreats. So I will just read that for you. Anupada Sutta, one by one as they occurred. Thus have I heard, on one occasion the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jetha's grove, Anatha Pindika's park. Now there is many of the suttas start with Jetha's grove, Anatha Pindika's park. There is a small short story about that also. Jetha was the prince and Anatha Pindika was the merchant. So the merchant Anatha Pindika wanted to buy this grove or the park he wanted to buy. So he approached Jetha and he asked him to sell this park. Jetha was a very proud prince and he did not want to sell his property to a merchant. So that would not be considered kind of good in his eyes. So he demanded a sum of amount which was he thought was impossible to give for Anatha Pindika. He said, cover the land with gold. The amount of land you cover with gold would be yours. So Anatha Pindika was a wealthy merchant. So he called in two bullock carts worth of coins, gold coins, and started laying the coins. And some of his Jetha's servants said that Anatha Pindika is doing this. So he came running to see. He was really surprised that why would a merchant do this. So then he asked him, why are you doing this? This is not the cost of a land, you know, covered with gold. So then Anatha Pindika explained that this is the land I am buying for the Buddha, and we will make a stay for the Buddha over here. And Jetha was so impressed that he said, whatever gold coins you have put, that is the land I have sold to you. Rest of the land I donate. So that's the reason both the names are coming in this. Jetha's grove, Anatha Pindika's park. So Jetha donated the land, but Anatha Pindika paid for some part of the land. So this is a kind of an interesting story. And Buddha spent a lot of rains retreats in this place. That's the reason many of the suttas start with him being in Anatha Pindika's park. There he addressed the bhikkhus, the students thus. Students, venerable sir, they replied. The Blessed One said this. Students, Sāriputta is wise. Sāriputta has great wisdom. Sāriputta has wide wisdom. Sāriputta has joyous wisdom. Sāriputta has quick wisdom. Sāriputta has keen wisdom. Sāriputta has penetrative wisdom. During half a month, Sāriputta gained insight into states one by one as they occurred. Now Sāriputta's insight into states one by one as they occurred was this. Before this, we just briefly explain that Sāriputta and Moggallana were considered to be the two chief disciples of the Buddha. Sāriputta was considered the right hand, Moggallana was considered the left hand. Sāriputta is considered to be great in wisdom, and Moggallana was considered great in psychic abilities. But it does not mean that Sāriputta did not have psychic abilities. He had all the psychic abilities, and that does not mean that Moggallana did not have wisdom. He had wisdom, but there is a difference in the quantity or the quality of the wisdom and psychic ability. So both of them are chief disciples, and all the Buddhas which come will also have chief disciples, which are like Sāriputta and Moggallana, and all the previous Buddha also had chief disciples. One of the lifetimes before, the story goes is that Sāriputta saw a chief disciple of a Buddha and had a desire to be a chief disciple of the next Buddha, and he made a determination. And because of that determination in the work he did, he became Buddha's chief disciple. So this is a kind of a story from the commentaries. Here bhikkhus quite secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome state. What is secluded from sensual pleasures? Sensual pleasures are any kind of sense related activities. That's the reason we close the eyes. Our eye senses are closed. We don't pay attention to what is sound is there. We don't pay attention to the smell. We keep our we are not eating anything. We keep our mouth closed. We sit in a position, in a one single position. We don't move around, and we keep our mind on the object of meditation. We don't go to whatever thoughts are coming. So that is because we are becoming secluded, and we are becoming secluded from unwholesome states. Unwholesome states are anything which increases our greed, delusion, and hatred. Are the states where we are getting, we are avoiding those things. So those are the things we do to start our meditation. Sāriputta entered upon and abided in first jhana, which is accompanied by applied or initial thought and sustained thought with rapture and pleasure born of seclusion. So the first state of jhana Sāriputta attained was the jhana where there is an initial thought. Initial thought is the thought comes up in our mind. So this about a flower, say. And then the sustained thought is all the things about the flower. Oh, I had this flower before. I should get this flower. Or I should ask this person to kind of buy this flower. So whatever thoughts are there, those are the sustained thoughts which are there. There are continuous thoughts which come up. So there is an initial thought which pops up, and then there is a sustained amount of thought. So that thought process is still there in the first jhana. So you may get an idea and you may go through, but those are wholesome thoughts you will get. So in that thought process you may be able to kind of analyze a certain dhamma things. And I'll just point out the other points also. And the states in the first jhana, the applied thought or the initial thought and the sustained thought, the rapture. Rapture is a kind of pleasure. In Buddha's description of joy and pleasure and happiness, sometimes the translations are kind of interchanged. So the easiest way to understand the gradation of the joy, pleasure or rapture is the amount of excitement which is there in the body. The amount of excitement which is more is considered to be a lower kind of. When this excitement level is finer, and at one point there is no excitement, that is the upekkha state, that is the equanimity. So that is the highest level a human being can be in, that is in equanimity. So there is rapture in the first jhana, the pleasure and the unification of mind. Unification of mind is that the mind has come upon and is able to examine something in a proper manner. The contact, feeling, perception. The contact, feeling and perception is that you can have contact on your body, then the feeling is also there, and this feeling is not feelings. They are not emotional feelings, they are sensations. Feeling, you can have, the feeling is there, and there is perception. Perception means you are able to discern. So if a fly lands on your arm, you know that this fly is there. So there is that kind of feeling and perception is there. And one other thing about contact, feeling and perceptions are that they are conjoined, they are not disjoint. They are not, when there is a feeling, when there is a contact, there is also a feeling and there is a perception for that. So those things are coming together, because we cannot have a feeling without perceiving it, and without contact there cannot be a feeling. So those things come together. Volition and mind. That means that you have a choice of what to do. So you have a decision making power over here. The zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity. So over here also, in the first jhana there is equanimity. Traditionally what it is told is that fourth jhana you get equanimity. But over here the equanimity is a kind of one-legged equanimity. When you stand on one leg, you are able to stand, but you are little wobbly. Then in the second jhana you get two-legged equanimity. You can stand, but you can stumble. In the third jhana you have a three-legged equanimity. And on the fourth jhana you get the four-legged equanimity. There you have equanimity which is well established. In the arupa jhanas, again you come to an equanimity state. So there is a refinement on that equanimity also. So as you progress, your equanimity is refined. And attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. So what he is saying is, he is able to see how one by one it arises, it stays, and they are, and they, and known they disappear, then they go away. So it comes on its own, it stays on its own, and goes on its own. So he is just an observer, he is just seeing. So what the words are there is, known to him these states arose. He is knowing that the states are there. And by when he is observing this states, known they were present, known they disappeared. He understood thus, so indeed, these states not having been, come into being. Having been, they vanish. Regarding those states, he abided unattracted. So he was not attracted to whatever has come up. He was not trying to grasp that thing. He was not trying to keep those things. Unrepelled. So he was not trying to repel it also. Independent, detached, free, disassociated, with a mind rid of barriers. A mind rid of barriers is the five hindrances. That is sensual pleasure, ill will, sloth and torpor, restlessness and remorse, and doubt. So when you are in a jhana, you are rid of barriers. Those hindrances are considered barriers to your progress. So now when you are there in this state, you are getting away from those five, and any jhana state which you are there, you do not have those barriers. He understood there is an escape beyond, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So what he is saying is, there is an escape beyond this, means that there is this first jhana which I am able to discern, but there is a state which is above or beyond this jhana. And then he continues his practice and knows by attaining second jhana that yes, there is an escape from this first jhana, there is a higher attainment. And this is the kind of same thing which happened with the Buddha. When the Buddha first went and became an ascetic, and he went to a teacher. The teacher was teaching the Indian system, where he was able to attain the nothingness, that is considered to be third arupa jhana. So when he thought that he had attained it, after learning it and he had attained it, he thought that there is something beyond this. because there are defilements still which are there with me. There is something beyond this. And he went to another teacher. So, Udaka Ramaputta. So, now Udaka Ramaputta's father had attained a state which is called neither perception or non perception. That is the fourth Arupaja state. So, he said that I will teach you. Then he learned that, and when he mastered that state, he said that he had still something beyond that. And thus, he went ahead and tried other practices. There is a list of practices in some of the suttas that are given. And finally, he realized that once when he was a child, he had experienced a jhanic state, which was tranquil jhana. That is what my teacher gives it the name, tranquil jhana. So this is the same way we are teaching you, that we believe that the Buddha discovered or remembered as a child when he had attained the tranquil jhana. And after that, he did his practice once again and attained an awakening. Again, bhikkhus, with the stilling of applied or initial and sustained thought, Sāriputta entered and abided in the second jhana, which has self-confidence and singleness of mind. Without initial and sustained thought, with rapture and pleasure born of concentration. And the states in the second jhana, the self-confidence, the rapture, the pleasure and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling, perception, volition and mind, the zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. He understood there is an escape beyond this, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So in the second jhana also, you see that all the states or all the awareness of a student in practice is still there in the second jhana. So he is able to have his contact, feeling, perception, volition of mind is still there. He is a student in meditation in the second jhana, is also able to be able to recognize what is happening. And what is happening in the jhana states is clear to the student. Again, bhikkhus, with the fading away of rapture, Sāriputta abided in equanimity and mindful and fully aware. So in the third jhana, the rapture kind of fades away. The coarse kind of happiness which is there, it fades away. Sāriputta abided in equanimity. Equanimity is still there over here in the third jhana. And mindful and fully aware, still feeling pleasure with the body. So there is still a refined amount of pleasure in the body the student is feeling at this point in the third jhana. He entered upon and abided in the third jhana, on account of which noble ones announce he has a pleasant abiding, who has equanimity and is mindful. So this is called the pleasant abiding. Third jhana is considered to be pleasant abiding. And one of the points which we have to figure out is that can somebody stay in a jhana in life when doing normal things? So there is a sutta where there are mention of Sāriputta and sometimes Aniruddha explaining that how they spent the full day in the first jhana or the second jhana or the third jhana or the fourth jhana. So till the third Arupa jhana of nothingness or equanimity, you will be able to walk and do walking meditation and do activities in those jhana states. So in the jhana states, it is called pleasant abiding. So if you want to kind of stay in a pleasant way, then third jhana is considered to be a pleasant abiding. But you will be able to, as you progress and as you develop your determinations. Determination is what I had told and reminded you in the first day, that you have to, when you are sleeping, determine a time. When you have determined a time, then if you hit that time, then change that time and keep on trying to work on having that determination. And then one other determination you can make is determine to wake up smiling. So every time you sleep, just make a determination that when I wake up, I will wake up smiling. So these are the determinations which work when we are in advanced practice, and then you want to use that practice to kind of abide in a full day in a particular jhana. That practice helps. And the states in the third jhana, the equanimity, the pleasure, the mindfulness, the full awareness. So in the third jhana also there is full awareness and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling, perception, volition and mind, the zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose, known they were present, known they disappeared. He understood thus that there is an escape beyond this, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So, Sāriputta, once he attained the third jhana, he knew that there is something beyond that, and then he worked towards attaining that state. Again, because with the abandoning of pleasure and pain and with the previous disappearance of joy and grief, Sāriputta entered upon and abided in the fourth jhana, which has neither pain nor pleasure. So the equanimity is a factor which is of the fourth jhana, and purity of mindfulness due to equanimity. And the states in the fourth jhana, the equanimity, the neither painful nor pleasant feeling, the mental unconcern due to tranquility. So there is an explanation, a footnote given, that as per the commentary, explains that the mental concern with pleasure, which consists in the third jhana, is now considered to be gross. And when it subsides, there is mental unconcern due to tranquility. So, as we told you that each stage of pleasure or happiness has a little bit of excitement, or there is a little bit of vibrations which are there. So, as you are in third jhana, that subtle vibration is also kind of too much for a meditator. When he goes to the fourth jhana, he lets go of that and he is in equanimity. So that there is a balance which is very defined. So the body is very comfortable at that point of time. The purity of mindfulness and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling and perception. So still there is contact, feeling and perception in the fourth jhana. Volition and mind, the zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity and attention. So all of this are present. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose, known they were present, known they disappeared. He understood thus, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. Again, students, with the complete surmounting of perceptions of form. So now we are saying that the perception of forms, you are going beyond that. So after fourth jhana, you go to the arupa states. So generally, sometimes we are explained as the fourth jhana, fifth jhana, sixth jhana, seventh jhana, eighth jhana. But my teacher does not like that kind of a classification. He likes the classification of the fourth jhana and then the first arupa jhana, second arupa jhana, third arupa jhana and fourth arupa jhana. So you enter into a jhana where the body is not there. It's a pure mental state. With the disappearance of perceptions of sensory impact, with non-attention to perceptions of diversity, aware that space is infinite, Sāriputta entered upon and abided in the base of infinite space. So the base of infinite space is still there in the metta, and you still feel that feeling, but you may feel that there is an expansion, or you are contracting and the room is becoming bigger, something like that you may feel, or you may feel like that your perception is going endlessly in a void, and you are traveling endlessly and there is no end to it. So you have a kind of an insight into the infiniteness of space. So there may be kind of constant expansion, or there may be kind of a gentle expansion. You may just feel in the mind that the mind is just expanding like that, or you may feel that the room is kind of getting bigger and bigger. So those kind of feelings are experienced by one who is entering this space. And the states in the base of infinite space, the perception of the base of infinite space, and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling and perception. So still there is contact, feeling and perception when you are in the first arupa jhana. So if a fly lands on your arm, you are able to feel. But this time what happens, your mind does not go to it. Your mind stays over here and you are just aware that something has happened. Generally when a fly lands on your arm or your face, your mind gets disturbed. So now when you are in a fourth jhana and above, then your mind is very balanced and you will be able to know, but you will not, mind will not vibrate, or you will not go over. The zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. He understood thus that there is escape beyond this, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So he continued his practice. Again, because by completely surmounting the base of infinite space, aware that consciousness is infinite, Sāriputta entered upon and abided in the base of infinite consciousness. Now, in the base of infinite consciousness, what happens is you are able to see individual consciousnesses arise and subside. So you may find that as you are feeling in infinite space, you are expanding. In the space of infinite consciousness, you will see that it is contracting, and you will be able to see individual arising and falling. You may see it in the eyes, like a blinking feeling. So this darkness also you are seeing is blinking, that is, you are seeing individual arising and falling. You may feel in the skin, the feeling may be coming as a as flashes, or hear something, and you may hear those sounds which are broken up, and they are not a clear sound, but it kind of breaks up like this. It is broken up. It is not a continuous sound, and that is a way you are experiencing the impermanent nature of all things. Impermanent nature of the eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the body, the mind, everything is impermanent. And when you stay in that state for a long time, realize that everything which is there arises and falls away. So there is nothing solid to anything. So this is a state, and over here the feeling changes. It becomes a little softer. So it is compassion over here. So from metta you go to karuna. Now I'll continue with this. And the states in the base of infinite consciousness, the perception of the base of infinite consciousness, and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling and perception. So in this state and the second arupa jhana also, there is contact, feeling and perception, volition and mind, the zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity and attention. So you have the volition faculty also, and the attention faculty also still continues with this aroma jhana. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. He understood thus that there is an escape beyond this, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. Again, because by completely surmounting the base of consciousness, aware that there is nothing, Sāriputta entered upon and abided in the base of nothingness. And the states in the base of nothingness, the perception of the base of nothingness, and the unification of mind, the contact, feeling, perception, volition, and mind. The zeal, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. He understood thus that there is an escape beyond, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So, I just misspoke in the last this thing. The last in the infinite consciousness, you are in the Karuna Mudita, that is in the joy state. There is a joy state, and in infinite space you are in Karuna, and now you will be in Upekha. So Upekha is the equanimity state. Now generally what happens is that you have this feeling of joy which comes, and this is called the enlightenment joy. This part of the joy is called the enlightenment joy, and this is the part of the seven factors of awakening. The seven factors of awakening joy, that is the joy you are feeling at this point of time. And after that, what happens is, when you are there, there will be there is a little bit of activity going on, like there is flashes which are going on. You are able to have this feeling of joy is also has a little bit of vibrations. Now you go, and then there is nothing. It would be like a blank state, as if you are looking at a wall which is dark wall, and there is nothing. And then there is a state of absolute balance. That equanimity has the perfect balance, and that balance you stay. And sometimes what happens is, you may feel that, oh, I have fallen away. Because I was feeling this joy, there was some activity going on, and now nothing is happening. So I have fallen away. But that is not the case. You have actually progressed. At this point of time, you have progressed to the equanimity. So many times this happens that students come up, and I myself also, I had gone to my teacher and told him that Bhante Vimalaramsi, that this has happened. And then he said, okay, I know what is happening, you know. So this balance is the balance where you have to put in the least amount of energy to balance your state. So there is a very fine, refined practice you have to do at this level. So you don't have to put too much energy. If you feel a little bit dull, you will not feel sloth and torpor. You will feel dull, a little bit dull. Then you have to put in a little bit energy. Then you may feel a little bit restless. And then you have to take out a little bit energy and become a little bit relaxed a little bit more. So there is a very small amount of energy we are working with this at this stage. Again, because by surmounting the base of nothingness, Sāriputta entered upon and abided in the base of neither perception nor non-perception. So this name is very important, neither perception nor non-perception. So this state means that there is no perception. We cannot say that. Or we cannot say there is perception. We cannot say that also. So we cannot say anything. So we cannot say that there is neither perception. We cannot say there is perception nor non-perception. Or we cannot say there is non-perception. Because if there is a non-perception, then you are unconscious. Because consciousness has perception. You cannot be unconscious and perceive, or you cannot perceive and be unconscious. These states cannot be conjoined, they cannot exist together, you know. So this state is a state which is a very refined state. After this, we call this state a quiet mind. For ease of explaining, neither perception nor perception, we say it's a quiet mind. So you have to be really aware what is happening over here. And there is a special phrase which is there, which I will explain. He emerged mindful from that attainment. So now what is the phrase he is using? He emerged mindful from that attainment. So he was there in the state of neither perception or non-perception. He emerged mindful from that attainment. So now this is very important. Having done so, he contemplated the state that had passed, ceased, changed. So after emerging from that state, he then contemplated those things. So when you are in quiet mind, we ask you to before you get up, you take 10 minutes and look at whatever has happened. There may be a slight changes which may have happened. There may be the darkness is there, but the darkness just moved or anything, something or the other. Then you sit up post your session. So what has happened is, in that state, it is so refined that those things which he did in even nothingness, he will not be able to do at this point. So he gets out of that attainment and then he analyzes what has happened. So having done so, he contemplated the states that had passed, ceased, changed. Thus, so indeed, these states not having been, come into being, having been, they vanish. Regarding those states, he abided unattracted, unrepelled, independent, detached, free, dissociated, with a mind rid of barriers. He understood there is an escape beyond, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So, in neither perception or non-perception, he realized that there is something beyond that neither perception, that refined feeling which is there. There is a feeling which is beyond that. So you can be able to go beyond that also. Again, by completely surmounting the base of neither perception nor non-perception, Sāriputta entered and abided in the cessation of perception and feeling. So it can be said the cessation of perception, feeling and consciousness, because consciousness is a part, they are all together. They are conjoined, not disjoined. So we can say the cessation of perception and feeling. And his chains were destroyed by him, his seeing with wisdom. So what happens is that there is a cessation. At that time it is like a switching off of the computer. So when you switch off the computer, everything goes off. But then there is it's in the restart mode, so it restarts. And when it restarts, it runs a program. If you see, there is something which goes on. So there is a kind of program which runs. And that time, the act of Nibbana is there. Then when you are mindful, you will be able to see what is happening, and that gives you insight into the dependent origination. Even if you had not read about dependent origination, even if you had no prior informational knowledge about independent origin, you will get it clear over that, at that point. He emerged mindful from that attainment. Having done so, he recalled the states that had passed, ceased and changed us. So indeed, these states not having been, come into being, having been, they vanished. Regarding those states, he abided unattracted, unrepelled, independent, detached, free, disassociated, with a mind rid of barriers. He understood there is no escape beyond, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is not. So what Sāriputta is saying, that the Nibbana is the final escape. There is no escape beyond Nibbana. So once you have attained Nibbana and you have awakened, that is the final escape you will have. So this samsara, when we are going through the samsara, we are going through the samsara because of what we are wanting. That is, as per Four Noble Truths, it is said that there is dukkha, there is a cause of this dukkha. The cause is our attachments or cravings. There is a solution, that is abandoning the same craving. And there is a path which leads to that abandonment. And what we are doing is this is the path which we are following. And by knowing this, he knows that there is nothing beyond that. Because rightly speaking, were it to be said of anyone, he has attained mastery and perfection in the noble virtue, attained mastery and perfection in noble concentration, attained mastery and perfection in noble wisdom, attained mastery and perfection in noble deliverance. It is of Sāriputta indeed that rightly speaking, this should be said. Because, again rightly speaking, were it to be said of anyone, he is the son of the Blessed One, born of his breast, born of his mouth, born of the Dhamma, created by Dhamma, heir to the Dhamma, not an heir in material things. It is of Sāriputta indeed that rightly speaking, this should be said. Because the matchless wheel of the Dhamma set rolling by the Tathagata is kept rolling brightly by Sāriputta. This is what the Blessed One said. The students were satisfied and delighted in Blessed One's words. So this is the end of the Sutta. So we see that how Sāriputta or the Buddha is explaining to us that how this is path is progressing. So slowly the path gets progressed. In our how our teacher Bhante Vimalaramsi teaches is that when the feeling of metta goes to the head, that is the time when we give you another practice. That practice is considered to be at the level of the fourth jhana. After that, you may experience the arupa jhana states, that is the infinite space, infinite consciousness, nothingness, and quiet mind, neither perception or non-perception. So those states you will be experiencing, and as you balance in that experience, as you refine that experience, at one point the balance of the seven factors of awakening is there in the mind, and then the cessation occurs. And the cessation occurs, and when you come out of cessation, you will know there is a rebooting kind of a thing is happening, and you recognize what is there. Then you will be asking you some questions regarding that when you when come for the interview. So we kind of make sure that that is the experience actually you have felt. So there are certain factors which are there, how you feel and see and everything. So those things we cross examine you at that point of time to find out. And that is just a we do not we are not we are just responding to what you are telling us in the interview. We are not using our psychic abilities or anything like that. So this is not we are not endorsing anything. We are just the process. Some of us the teachers have experienced. And my teacher himself, Bhante Vimalaramsi, does not claim to have psychic abilities. He says he does not have inclination of his mind. But there are his students who have psychic abilities. And they have. He has proved with cross-examining them. When my teacher had a student who came and said that I have a divine eye has opened for me. And I am able to see wherever I want to see. So then my teacher asked, tell me where my mother is and what is she wearing. So he told that your mother is staying over here, this is the address, and she is wearing the denim overalls. At same time my teacher called his mother. That time she was alive. So he called her and said, what are you doing and what are you wearing? So she said, I am over here and I am gardening, I am wearing denim overalls. And then he just put the phone down and he continued. So he confirmed that this has happened. And he has seen so that is based on the inclination of the mind. So not everybody is inclined towards having psychic abilities. Some people have psychic abilities without attaining awakening. So they have, before they have attained awakening, they have attained psychic abilities. That is there in suttas also, many of the suttas there is a mention of Devadatta, the cousin of the Buddha. He had attained psychic abilities because he was more interested in that before he had attained awakening. And after he misused those psychic ability, he forego the attainment of awakening also, and his psychic ability also went away. So the inclination of our mind determines what is the psychic ability. So whatever we are saying to you is based on our experience, personal experience, and what the experience of our students are there, what the experience of my teachers are there. So based on that, we kind of confirm what is happening. And this is based on your feedback which you are giving. What you feedback you give, we give that feedback back. So that is that. And if there are some questions, I'll just take your questions from here first. How do we know that we have progressed in the path we have
undertaken?
So the progress is something which we kind of have shown over here about the jhānas. And there is a certain time we will ask you to change the practice. So when one way of seeing progress is when the metta feeling goes to the head. That means that you are in the fourth jhana. That time we change the practice. We give you a practice of testing your mind, which is done once, which is called breaking down the barriers. So we send through 15 more people the metta and see if they respond back to us. That is one way of knowing your progress. The other way, when you are talking to us in our interviews, we know what is happening. But we do not point out, because that is not the time to for you to know about what is your progress. Your time of to know is when you want to change the practice. That is in the fourth channel. So that is the time you will inform. The other way of measuring the progress is how long you are sitting, how comfortably you can sit. Say you start with 30 minutes and you kind of progress to an hour, you go to 2 hours. So that is a way of this thing, measuring your progress. Third is how long you are able to send to the metta. Initially you may be sending for 5 seconds, 10 seconds, and it may go to 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 15 minutes. That is also a measure of progress. So those ways you can measure for yourself how you are progressing in the practice. What is right?
Righteousness.
I don't understand the word righteousness. What is the meaning of righteousness? To be right?
I don't know. You mentioned this righteousness yesterday. So I wanted to know.
I mentioned this word righteousness. So I don't recall that. Maybe I may have mentioned it in the, because righteousness can be mean a lot of different things. I cannot recall how in which context I had used that. But we do not believe in the righteousness of anything.
So when you talk about eightfold path,
Eightfold path, the right path is there, and then there is a false path. The Buddha has told about the right path and the false eightfold path. So that is the path we use. The right eightfold path is leading you to Nibbana. The wrong eightfold path is leading you towards the greed, hatred, and delusion. That what leads you to more greed, hatred, and delusion is the wrong path, which diminishes those things as the right path. So that is the only distinction. What is your idea of better human being? A better human being is the one who is kind to oneself and he is kind to others. So that is the definition of the better human, because he does not cause harm to himself and does not cause harm to others. And another way of as an individual is that he follows the 5 precepts. When a person follows the 5 precepts, there are many harms he can avoid. By first is not killing. That is a lot of harm he is avoiding. Then by not stealing, Even if I had this pen and somebody took this pen, I would feel a little hurt. Even if this pen is a kind of, in money terms, not much, but I still feel the hurt of a missing pen, you know. So that by not stealing or not taking what is not given, you avoid a lot of pain. By having the right sexual activity, that means that in this context, is having no sexual activities of any kind. But in the five precepts, it means that not to have adultery. That means not to have a partner who is not your permanent partner. So that is the one thing. The second thing is not to hurt the partner in any way. And the third thing is not to have a partner who is underage or still living with the parents in the guardianship. So that those are the things you avoid a lot of hurt by not doing that, you know. If you do all those things, you cause hurt. Now in right speech, there are right speech which is harsh speech. When you speak harsh words, you hurt somebody. Then there is idle talk. You kind of waste somebody's time, and your time you waste, idle talk. Then there is a talk which is a talk you use to make two groups fight each other. So those things, and then you speak lies. So those kind of speech hurts somebody. And then the last is the drinking part, the drinking of alcohol and having any kind of drugs, which are psychotropic drugs, where you are getting intoxicated. So one story goes about, this is about another this thing, but the story goes that there was a very good person, okay? He was a wealthy merchant. He used to love his wife, and he had a very good servant. He used to kind of take care of his servant and feed him well, pay him well. And he used to have a happy life. So the devil comes, the Mara comes to him and says that I will give you some eternal life or something he offers. Or offers the kingship or something like that, something he offers. So he says that what do I have to do? He says beat your wife. That is the only thing I ask him. Beat your wife and you can have this thing. So he said, no, I love my wife, I will not be able to do it. He said, okay, then kill your servant. Sacrifice him to me and I will give you. He said, no, my servant is like my brother. I cannot do that. Then at the end he says, okay, drink this alcohol. So that is the one bottle of alcohol, he just drink. So he said, okay, that is the least amount I can do. So he starts drinking alcohol. When he starts drinking alcohol, his wife comes and kind of complains, why you are doing that, you are such a nice person, you have never touched alcohol. And now he is intoxicated and he becomes very angry with the wife and starts beating his wife. Now after he starts beating his wife, the servant sees it and out of compassion he comes to stop. And because he becomes that, if he is coming in between my wife, so he kills the servant. So the intoxication is also a factor which can kind of lead to breaking of all the other precepts. So that is one point. And the second point is the intoxication is avoiding those intoxicants is asked by the Buddha, because we work with the mind. And you have, when you have intoxicants or any kind of psychotropic things, your mind gets dulled. They say that people who have just one beer, one glass of beer, and they have done a test on driving, their driving ability has decreased. This is well below the legal limit, one glass of beer. But just having one glass of beer, when they have taken the test, they have this standard test they take, driving tests, and they have found that the performance has reduced. So any amount of alcohol kind of dulls the mind. We may not be able to know from the speech or anything, but the actions kind of change. So that also harms people in the kind of story I told you or other ways. Like when a person just drinks and maybe he is in an accident and he kills somebody. And maybe he kills himself. That is harm to himself, or he can harm others. So by following the five precepts, one can become a good person. And one of the things in suttas is, in many of the suttas, this is not talked about much, but in many of the suttas it has been told that if you keep the five precepts and you contemplate about Buddha Dhamma Sangha, that is, so they say, what are the qualities of the Buddha, what are the qualities of the Dhamma, what are the qualities of the Sangha, you contemplate that regularly, not chanting, not just chanting those things. The Buddha is saying recollecting it, means you contemplate about that things, then you can consider yourself a sotapatta. So keeping the spirit precepts is a very kind of important aspect. So you should always keep your precepts, and that makes you a better person, and that also inclines your mind towards Nibbana. So that is a very important thing. Which is important for being human being, mind or heart? See, mind and heart is kind of in many of the like Thai tradition, mind and heart are used interchangeably. So because certain times we say that this is heart and this is mind, but the mind is where the heart is also there. Because that is the emotional part of your mind, is considered the heart, but it is not a different organ. So as we understand, this heart is over here and the mind is over here, but they are using it interchangeably. So chitta they use the word chitta. So chitta is used for heart also and mind also. So both are important, because you cannot be too emotional also and you cannot be too analytical also. So you have to have a balance of that. So when you have balance, and Buddhism is all about balance. So whatever Buddha says is to bring us in balance. You should not sit very comfortably, or you should not sit very in a way you are uncomfortable and painful. So you have to have that balance. So sitting also there is a balance. In practice also there is a balance. So the balance is of the mind and the body, which is there, and the balance with the mind and the heart is to be maintained. So there is no one or the other. You should have the balance. The balance kind of enhances your this thing, how you operate. That is enhanced by the balance.
Last question.
Yeah.
What is jhana?
Jhana has many meanings, but the simplest meaning my teacher Bhante Vimalaramsi gives is the level of knowing, jhana. So like in Hindi we say jhana, jankari. So that is knowing. So that is the level of your knowing. So first jhana is the level where you know. Second jhana is that level you know. So that is the meaning of jhana. Jhanas are in a certain tradition considered to be too unattainable, because they are going through a different route to attain the jhana. The route is the samatha, that is of concentration. So you get absorbed in your object of meditation. When a person is there in the samatha jhana and you are absorbed in that object of meditation, people have cut them and they have not reacted. There is a doctor in Sri Lanka. He got this guy on the television. He asked him to go into the first jhana. Then he cut him. This guy did not react. Then he, without anesthetic, he stitched the cut. And then got him back. And he had a predetermined time that he was going to be in that jhana. So that jhana, you have nothing, the mind does not move at all. So that is considered to be too much old at this end. And the other end is doing pure vipassana. Vipassana you do, and you, that is, you don't have attainment of even a jhana. And through just pure study, you try to attain. You can attain up to sakdagami by pure study. But you should have a very sharp mind, and that is a rare thing. You should have a very sharp mind in understanding the Dhamma. And the best combination the Buddha which is he's recommending is that you, those two should be yoked together. There should be a aspect of Samatha and there should be an aspect of Vipassana. That's the reason the practice is called tranquil wisdom, which is Samatha, and insight, which is Vipassana. So tranquil wisdom, insight, meditation, twin. So we yoke together both. So you will find that as you progress, you are able to sit longer and you are able to also investigate the mental activities which are happening. So like Sāriputta in this, all these jhānas, he is not in a state where he is unable to examine. So he has Samatha, but he also has Vipassana. Those things which he is saying, it not being there, it came, and it having been, it gone, what is that? That's an insight. And being able to stay in that jhana, what is that? That is Samatha. So that both are there, Samatha and Vipassana, both are there in this practice. So that is what we are seeing over here, where Sāriputta is explaining. And Sāriputta took more time than Moggallana because he analyzed it more. He looked at it more because he wanted to get into the depth of the matter. So he took more time. Moggallana had attained in 1 week awakening, and Sāriputta took 2 weeks. And it is said that when initially Kondanya, Venerable Kondanya, when he told Sāriputta half a verse that for all things which are arising, for that the cessation has been told. So for all things which are arising, just that sentence he attained a Suttapanna. So he was so sharp, but he analyzed it little more time. And he took more time to analyze and explain to us. And Sāriputta used to take care of the students also of the Buddha. So there are many Sāriputta and Moggallana both together take care of the students and take them to awakening. And many of the suttas they mention that there are groups of Sotapanna who have the path. Then there are groups which are Sotapanna with fruition. There are groups with Sagdagami path, and then there are groups with Sagdagami fruition. There are Anagami path with Anagami fruition, and there are groups with Arahant who have path. And they are all in training. So they have analyze those things. So there is a lot of information which you can get from the suttas reading it. Yes.
You ask?
Yes.
Guruji, I've been to Jetavan, you mentioned in the beginning now. So I just saw the path and some ruins, but I didn't see temple. Has it been a temple there? No.
Jethwa, I am not sure because I have not gone to many places, so I am not sure about the temple.
There is no temple. There is a big, huge park and peaceful area with some ruins.
Okay. So the temples and see what has happened is that one thing about Buddhist archaeology is that all the archaeological sites which has been discovered by were not discovered by Buddhists. They were discovered by neutral people who were mostly British amateurs, not even archaeologists. Most of them were amateur, and there were amateur archaeologists who discovered that. And many of them, by discovering those architectures and the text and deciphering the text, became Buddhists. And they started following the Buddha's path. So this is a kind of a thing about Buddha's whatever the iconography is there and everything is there. So there are many which are lost because there is a time after Buddha's, after 500 years, the Buddhism was attacked very viciously. And there were thousands, they are told that monks were killed and all those things have happened. So many of the things have kind of lost time. So those are, in Buddha's perspective, those are not kind of important iconographies. But the most important thing is the Dhamma, which is there. Because when once the Buddha was asked that that as students we stay in dependence of the Buddha. So what, whose dependence does the Buddha stay in? So Buddha said, I stay in dependence of the Dhamma. So Dhamma is not something which is an invention of the Buddha, it's a discovery. So the Dhamma is always there. She says, even if there is a Buddha or there is no Buddha, the dependent origination, what is happening? Whatever, these are laws, and these laws will continue to happen. Even if there is a Buddha or no Buddha, that does not make a difference. How this thing is functioning, how your mind is, attention is moving from one thing to another, and how it is causing you pain, will be there universal. It will be there till the time is there. But the Buddha comes and then he discovers this path. That is the reason he said in that sutta yesterday, that as the path is lost, he clears the path and destroys the dummy and takes and gives a clear path to the fellow people to attain, escape from this samsara. So that is, the Dhamma is more important than other temples or any iconography or any other thing. And Buddha said that when you have a crisis of faith, or then you can visit my four places. But that is not kind of a requirement for a Buddhist to go and there. There are many religions where it's a requirement that you have to go. But he says that just if you want to get inspired, then you can come. But there is no requirement for anybody to go there. So that is an important factor, that Dhamma has been given the chief importance in the religion. Because with this Dhamma, we can ourselves attain Nibbana. So one other thing my teacher says is that we are guides and you are the teachers. So you teach yourself what is happening, what is there, and how this is happening. You teach yourself. So we are just the guides and you are the teachers. So you each have to learn by yourself.
And Guruji, like we are here, is it the heart or it is the mind which directs us to come?
It is basically your karmic this thing, fruition. Because there is a lot to be said about being born as a human being. Buddha once explained that if there was, the whole earth was an ocean, and there was a turtle which came, reared its head out in once in 100 years, and then there was a cap which was just enough for the turtle's head, that was floating, that ring was floating around in the ocean somewhere, and the turtle was coming up once in 100 years. The turtle coming up and the ring being there in the same place, what are the odds of that? Somebody can kind of calculate that odds. He's a statistician. So that is the odd of one being born as a human being. And then what are the odds that you will be born in a Mahakapa? Mahakapa, to understand a Mahakapa is only very difficult. One explanation is given, the 1 mile granite stone is there, which is 1 mile width, 1 mile height, and 1 mile of depth. Somebody comes with a soft cloth, silk cloth, and wipes it once in 100 years. And by this effort, the whole granite is exhausted and it disappears. That is the time of one Mahakapa. And there are many Mahakapas where there are no Buddhas. So that amount of time there is no Buddha is there. So that is a rare occasion, and this Mahakapa is considered to be very rare, because I think there are four Buddhas, three or four Buddhas which are there in this Mahakapa, this era which is there. So there will be one more Buddha which will be there, Maitreya Buddha will come. That time the human age will be 100,000 years. So those are the rare occasions. occasions where the sealed away which we are talking about, the precepts are kept very diligently by people, and because those precepts are kept, they have long life. They, as ailments, they have just the ailments of going to the loo and hunger and aging and death. That are the only ailments they have, and they live for 100,000 years. But that time when the Maitreya Buddha will come, whenever he is giving a talk, when he gives a talk to 100,000 people, so he will be talking individually to them psychically. So he will be giving a talk, 100,000 talks he will be giving to at one time. If there are 100,000 people, those 100,000 people, with their inclination of their mind, he will teach them and they will all attain awakening. So that's it. But that is something also kind of a craving people have. I want to be there at the time of Maitreya. But when you can attain it now, you have the teaching and all the tools, then you should go ahead and attain this now, no, not to delay.
I have a question. According to you, do we, as if like, this is a human birth, is the next a human birth, or it can be anything?
It can be anything. So there are certain ways the next birth is kind of considered. One is by your attainments. See, if you have attained a sotapanna, then there is a possibility that you may be coming up as a human, or you may be born in a devaloka. Okay, so I am talking just about attainment. Later on, that is a different part. But say, if you are being born in a devaloka, it may happen that you can be successively born in devaloka and attain awakening. Then, if you are born in as human beings, then you may be born, there is another attainment between Sotapanna and Sattagami. You will be born as human being for two or three births and then attain awakening. And then there is a Sotapanna, and then there is Sattagami. If you are a Sattagami, you will be reborn as a human being once and then attain awakening. Then there is Anagami. Then you are not born as a human being, we are born in the Brahmaloka. And there you will attain, or on the way to the Brahmaloka you will attain this thing if you are an Anagami. So there are an Anagami, it has been explained very elaborately. It is like, if you are an Anagami, it can be attained just before your passing away, during your passing away, and at the moment of your passing away, or at the moment when you travel from here to the in between the Brahmaloka, touching the Brahmaloka, staying in Brahmaloka for a short time, or staying in Brahmaloka for a long time. You can attain any time, you can attain, but you are not born as a human being. And an arahant, there is no birth for an arahant. But for a human being who is a commoner, who has not studied Dhamma or not attained any jhanas or anything like that, it would depend on his karmic balance. So now what may happen is that the Buddha says that this can also lead to, if the person cannot see properly the whole picture, he can come to wrong conclusions. How it can come to wrong conclusions is that a person is there who has done good all his life, and he passes away, and he is reborn in a hell realm. If somebody sees this, he says that what you do good is has no effect. But if a Buddha is there, he can see the long, the whole chapter, and say that, okay, he had this coming, and for the good which he has done, he will attain the fruits later on. So that is a vision he has. But if you have a limited vision, by seeing beings passing away and being reborn, you may come to wrong conclusion. And that is the reason in I think Brahmajala Sutta, that is Dika Nikaya, the first Sutta, he talks about how those wrong views are kind of attained by your limited vision. You may see certain things like a bad person being reborn in heaven, and then you may come to wrong conclusion. So in this way, your wrong grasp of your limited understanding can lead to wrong views and the wrong kind of paths. So that is, you have to be careful about that, because people with psychic powers also can kind of lead you to wrong view. So that you have to be careful. But one thing, continuing with that topic, one of the things, one of the monks who was very much interested, Bhante Vimalaramsi was also interested. Her mother used to have a hospice. So he used to attend to people who were passing away. He said that if a person who is passing away, he is given precepts. So I think he found something akin to precepts in the Bible. And he used to read that, because he is from Missouri, it's a Bible belt. So he used to read from the Bible to the people who were passing away or who were near to their death. And he found that the people who really understood what the precepts are there and were able to grasp it, and they passed away in a better manner. So when you are passing away, if your mind state is good, then you have a better next life. But that does not mean that whatever bad you have done, you escape. At some point, you gain those things.
I have a follow-up question.
Yes.
Do you know where you are in this journey, like where are you? Any stages you spoke about?
Yes, I would know for myself, because I have insight into myself. But that is something which we are not supposed to talk about, nor it is considered impolite, because there is a kind of rule. There are monk rules. There are 227 monk rules, but four of them are considered to be very critical. One of those critical, which are called Parajika rules, is that a monk in his greed misrepresents his attainment. So by asking a monk about his attainment, you are kind of putting him in that spot. So that is something which you should not do as a lay person. There can be a monk can misunderstand or kind of overestimate himself, and may say, and he may kind of speak to his fellow monks about it, and he may have overestimated. That is not a problem. But if he deliberately kind of misrepresents that, then it becomes a problem. That is the reason universally it is said that you should not kind of discuss that. Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Can we enjoy sensual pleasures and still progress on the path?
See, sensual pleasures have, as you said over here, that there are always extremes, okay? But Buddhism is about balance. So there are instances where there are lay people who have attained anagami, which are mentioned. But they have stayed anagami and a lay person because they had commitments towards their parents. One of those stories where Buddha Kassapa, his attendant and supporter, was anagami. But his parents were blind. So he used to support the parents, and he used to make it in a, he was a potter, so he used to do it in a special way. He used to go to the river and wait for the sand to fall. He used to not dig, because when he digs, he can kill earthworms. So he used to wait for the sand to fall, and then that fallen sand from the banks of the river, he used to take to make pottery. And when he used to make those potteries, he used to just put those potteries out and put a basket. So whoever wants to take those potteries can take and pay what he they want to take. So he used to not do, he used to try and stay as pious life as possible. Then there is one example in Buddha's time. There was a lay follower, and that is the only lay follower who the Buddha used to send monks to have them teach the monks from the lay person. So, but he was also in a situation where he had to support his parents. So there, those are the things. But in sensual pleasures, if it is in balance, it is not considered to be bad. But if you over-indulge in the sensual pleasure, then you can kind of get attached to that, and by getting attached, you will not be able to do it. But say, one of the things Buddha says about rich people. Once a person was rich, but he was very miser. So the Buddha said that being rich and miser is like having a well decked out car, say, and going in the heat behind the car, walking behind the car. So you could have sat in the car and enjoyed the ride and avoided the sun, but you are walking behind the car. So that's also foolishness. So if you have the means, then you have the means, then you have to enjoy those means. And when you are giving also, in the giving also, Buddha says that first you give to the family, immediate family. Then you give to the extended family. Then you give to the extended community. Then you give to the government what is due to the government, your taxes. Then you give to the Dhamma or the religious, wherever which is there. So in that also he has said that he will take care of your immediate surrounding. So it, always there is a balance you have to maintain. So just because you enjoy good clothes or enjoy good food or enjoy comfortable dwellings, that does not kind of hinder. You have to, but you can get over and involved. Like I want this kind of clothes only, and I go to Milan to buy when this is coming. My boss was always going to Hong Kong to buy t-shirts because he wanted that t-shirt when it was released at that market. He used to buy that t-shirts and come back, and he used to say, "Oh, see this t-shirt which is there, it's not there in India. I am the only one who is wearing this t-shirt." There was an angry bird which had come up that gave. So that first t-shirts which were launched, he went to Hong Kong to buy those t-shirts and he came back with those t-shirts. And so that is overindulgence in your this thing. But you can buy comfortable clothes and enjoy that clothes. That is not a problem. If you have the means, you buy a good car. But then you want a Ferrari and you want a Ferrari with this model and you want this thing. Put in that car, and that kind of becomes over indulgence. So that is something which you have to avoid. So there is always a balance, and that balance comes from where you are. So a billionaire has a different balance to maintain, and a millionaire has a different balance to mention, and a kind of a salaried person has a different balance to mention. So, but the balance is not to overdo anything, that you can get attached to that, or by doing that, you are stuck in that kind of loop. So that is, that has to be your guiding light. Any other questions? Okay, then we'll share the merits. May suffering ones be suffering free, and the fear struck careless be. May the grieving shed all grief, and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we have thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting